Hi and welcome. My name is Kai. You're watching Tank Brusher. I'm doing German AFVs in 1/35th scale every week. It's actually a long time ago I asked you guys what you would like to see on my channel and you voted for a Stuck. Finally, now it's time to build one. Now everyone is building one, so why not? We will spend an awful lot of time completely weathering the cherry cans and the road wheels, since on Afrika Stucks it's most likely the accessories that bog us down to a point where motivation runs out. With the accessories out of the way, we can next episode weather the hell out of this vehicle. Okay, this is a Sturmgeschütz 3 Ausführung D Sonderverband 288. That's Broncos Stuck Ausführung D, model designation D. A model designation D on a Stuck is not a thing per se. Going by the external appearance, it's nothing more than the expansion or continuation of the model designation C under new contract and model designation, and therefore I selected a very special vehicle or small series of vehicles. There were four of these vehicles specially built for service in Africa with the Sonderverband 288 Special Purpose Unit 288, and one of these vehicles was already lost in Creta. It fell off the pier, it was damaged, three made it into Africa, and one was later captured and restored here on YouTube. I will put some links down below. That's one of the three you can see running today. So this is the first Bronco kit I actually built, and the only one I own for today, and I like it. I really like it, but I think it lacks a little bit of balance. The sprue looks really well detailed, really nice crisp mold, everything perfect. But the tools lack a little bit of detail. That's a little bit out of balance. And we get four sheets of photo etch with this vehicle. Okay, one goodie is of course the brass barrel. Unfortunately, they included a slight molded plastic one that has actually more detail on the front. And that's why I chose the plastic one. The wing nuts are really cute. Such small parts, perfectly molded. Okay, we get copper wire for the tow cable and clear parts for the front lights if you don't want to use the birdhouse. On the other hand, there are four sheets of photo etch parts, highly detailed, very nice to work with, but I think this scares some of you away from this kit, and I can feel with you. I had a lot of fear for using photo etch, for dealing with it, but it gets easier over time. This is what I can say to you, or what I can give you as a advice. Just take it as a challenge. We are getting better at it since we are humans after all, and doing is learning, learning is doing. Yeah, just take the challenge. A lot of these parts are optional, but some are not. So if you want to build a Bronco kit for yourself the first time, I would suggest you don't go for the Africa version, or you will lose this cherry can holder, this cherry can rig cage on the rear end of the vehicle. There's unfortunately no alternative included in the kit. That's a little bit a downside. So you will have to use a folding machine or something similar, good set of pliers, and you will be fine. At least I managed to get it together somehow. It's still not a masterpiece, but that's not what I'm after in the construction phase. The interior is incomplete, of course. We get a complete gun, or nearly complete gun. The major blunder are these air filters. For the version I built in this kit, there is no air hose attached, no connection hose for it. And the part I tried to fit doesn't fit. Anyways, let's continue with the tracks. We get workable single link tracks. They get, you know, laid out in a jig. You know this procedure, I guess. And the only thing I would like to add here is the spacing of the pins is fitting every other hole, so we don't have to deal with separate pins and can do this in a relatively short time. They go together well, and yeah, they stick together. I didn't glue the pins in, and I'm still fine with it. As for modules, I decided to build this thing in a few more modules than I usually would do. keeping most parts separated, like the fenders. That's why everything looks crooked for now, but it will fit together fine. And as you can see, especially in the rear of the vehicle, there's a lot of photo etch included. Just as a warning, you will have to deal with it. Otherwise, the tools could need replacement, and the rest of the vehicle was not a great challenge to deal with. But you can see I did not go for battle damage or major modifications. This has to do with the learning process. I'm willing to spend more time in the construction phase as I build up the confidence of reaching a good looking result in the end. So we will improve based on this. Okay, jump forward. The vehicle is painted in RAL 8000 and this is sprayed over my red primer color, of course. The camo scheme on these vehicles would be RAL 7008, and you have a good reference. The guys at Bovington Tank Museum put a great deal of effort into their Tiger 1, so we know what it is supposed to look like. And when you look at me here spraying the camo pattern, yeah, if you can find a camo pattern, you can keep it. No, they are actually very low contrast and much less contrast I would have expected. Yeah, you can see the camo pattern a little bit. It gets better in real light on daylight. You can see it clearly, but I think they are a little bit off. But I take it as a challenge for the weathering. I will see if I can rescue it or adjust it just a little bit. Compared to the later deck style, it's quite a difference. The vehicle got a little bit more brown. And now it's getting interesting. Compared to dark yellow, according to standard, they are so similar. I would say we can't make this out of a black and white image when we talk about Army Group South in Russia, for example. A lot of these vehicles had the Tropentarn as well. Okay, directly into the weathering of the road wheels. There are 12 of them, plus 4 on the vehicle, so it's quite getting repetitive, and this is why I want to get them out of the way very early in the build. And what you see me doing here is just dry brushing a light gray over rubber and tire from Ammo by MIG. That's my usual paint for painting these rubber bandages, and with the highlighting it's quite looking nice when we get to the wash later on. Of course I do a wash on the actual wheel. That's a dark brown wash for Africa vehicles. I call it deck wash. That's Ammo by MIG. It's an enamel product because I like the fast drying time. Well, not too fast, not too slow. What I want to show about this pin wash is I clean up the surface, removing the excess and not stippling it in. That's just this brown has a lot of staining capability on this bright yellow surface. Next step is highlighting the details on the tires. I use Ammo by MIG RAL 8000. That looks again very different as compared to the real colors. They are not quite sure what they are doing here. That's the complete thing washed and highlighted. The inside, of course, the outside of the tire get a wash with dark wash, another enamel product. That's basically a black wash you would take instead of a black oil paint, for example. And with the highlight and the wash, this manufacturing logo Continental, that's immediately jumping out. We get this hard contrast of this nearly black rim when the bandage meets the wheel. I really like this effect. That's quite subtle, and yeah, it's leading the way into a good weathering, starting of the weathering. Dry light soil is one of my favorite heavy mud products from Ammo by MIG. I like it for its micro texture. It looks a little bit grainy, not too slimy, and that's what I choose when I want to do caked on mud or dust that has accumulated or bound to the surface of the vehicle. I just stipple it in the rim and blend it. The most important part about mud is blending it with a stippling motion, in this case blurring the edge into the vehicle surface. Oh, that looks quite good in my eyes at least. And with the bright color it will be easy to adjust later down the road. Okay, the 16 road wheels gone, and yeah, very good first step in the process. I don't think they look too bad for a very dusty vehicle. I want to weather this thing down in dust and dirt. In a meaningful way, of course. One small accessory or component I can show you completely are the jerry cans. Yeah, we have photo etch for jerry cans. I'm complete stoked about this. This is so cool. Yeah, look at this. Having photo etch on a jerry can, I can't get over this. They captured a great amount of detail here with this. Yeah, look, the tools are really rough, but jerry cans with photo etch. Yeah, okay, let's get over it. I just built them completely in this episode now, since I would like to have the time in the next episode to weather the complete vehicle down. And I think accessories like this are bogging us down a lot, adding a lot of drag when the vehicle is already finished and you get lost in all the small bits and pieces and parts, and the whole thing turns into a never-ending story. So with a good picture in the mind of how the vehicle should look when it's finished, I can build them and weather them now completely. It's just so cool. The part count on a jerry can with, yeah, it's just cool. Of course, I glued them together as an array of jerry cans, so they are easy to handle and easy to manage. Three of them are water cans. They are painted in a dark gray to set them apart. And I start immediately with sponge chipping a little bit a darker color of the base tone to get an initial weathering started. And I do this, of course, with gray for the water cans, and for the petrol cans I use a different yellow. Again, this is this Ammo by MIG, RAL 8000, looking quite a little bit different as the real color one. Just saying, on the dark yellow, most brands are identical. On the Africa color tones, not really. So I selected three different filters. That's just by complete random selection, just to show the jerry cans are individual objects, not looking all the same, setting the a little bit a tonal variation, setting one apart from the other. I just guess they are from different stashes, from different manufacturing times, just looking a little bit different, making the whole thing more interesting. On a water can, there's a white cross on it. This prevents every idiot from filling petrol into it and making it useless for the rest of the product lifetime, and that's why they are marked in a cross. And I don't over-align this. That's just hand-painted, freehand, no stencil, nothing involved, and this will be fine in the end. And yes, on the jerry can there is molded into it 20 liter Wasser, 20 liter of water. That's really nicely detailed here. Hand painting them in the fashion I do here looks a little bit crude, but that's okay. I want them well used, and they are hidden away in this holder, in this rig, of course, taking a lot away from what we can actually see after this. I skipped the wash, and now I'm stippling on the Africa dust. That's a pigmented enamel paint, and it will have the appearance of a thinned down pigment with no actual binder. And this is just added as a stippling motion to give the appearance of a little bit adhering dust or dirt. That's one of the main features of this build, will be dealing with dust and dirt, and that's one step of doing it. I try to avoid pooling and hard edges, of course. And now, as a final step, I come in with the brush for brush chipping, chipping color from Ammo by MIG. And yeah, just showing a little bit more wear and tear. This could be done much more early on in the build, but I don't see any benefit of doing it much more early. I get away with doing it now. On the vehicle, we will have a little bit a different process of the steps I can show or I would like to do later on. I keep the brush chipping just to the edges where we use this thing in the rig later on. They are getting shaked about when the vehicle is driving, and I think there's a lot of rubbing and abrasion going on. Last step, fuel stains. These are jerry cans, they carry petrol, and so we can add a little bit of fuel that was spilled by filling or emptying it out. Yeah, with the coal dust environment, I think that's quite legit to do this that way. Okay, fixed into the carrying rig on the rear of the vehicle. It looks a little bit silly having one part already finished and the other not, but these jerry cans will be a guideline for the rest of the vehicle. So let's get a few steps further with the vehicle and have a look at the decals. There's no way I can cut a mask, a spraying mask for this crest. So we have to deal with the decals this time, and I go for a satin varnish underneath it. I try to avoid decals as often as I can, but on the other hand, this is serving two purposes here. First, clear coat plus decals coats are decals without silvering. Very basic scale modeling. Second thing is, I want to dust this vehicle down and creating the contrast on a yellowish surface, ochreish surface with bright dust does not work alone. I need this semi-gloss, this satin surface, to create a contrast to matte effect paints later on. You can see there was no problem with the decals, and the first step or last step I would like to take for this vehicle today in this episode is adding a filter on the lower half of the vehicle. I selected a filter with a light brownish tone, altering the ochre or the yellow a little bit into something more dirty to begin with. A filter used in a traditional way as a filter is used, something new to me, you have not seen me doing often. But this is the last step for today, and I think this looks quite a little bit different from before and gives us a good base to build up on in the next episode. So I will leave you alone here. See you next week. Happy modeling. And there's a final news I would like to share. I'm just 50 watch time hours short of becoming eligible to be a YouTube partner. And I would like to take these last seconds to thank you so much for your support. Thank you so much for subscribing to my channel. And yeah, just thank you and see you next week.